this April 6th. You're watching the English newscast on Future Television. I'm Yumna Nofa. These are today's headlines. U.S. Deputy Secretary of State Antony Blinken holds talks with Lebanese officials during a visit to Beirut, where they touch on terrorism and the Iran nuclear deal. Activists say the Yarmouk district in southern Damascus in Syria is experiencing continued bombardment and fighting between armed groups. And U.S. President Barack Obama affirms solidarity with Israel despite recent differences over the Iranian nuclear deal. An internal security forces unit raided overnight the house of a Syrian national on suspicion of having links to the murder of a Lebanese man. The state-run national news agency reported that 20-year-old Syrian Nawaf Abdelaziz Mansour, who is suspected of having links to the murder of a 50-year-old Lebanese, was detained. The Syrian resides in the town of At-Taibe in the eastern Baqa city of Baalbek, and Sulaiman Hamadi Al-Hamadi was found killed with a hunting rifle in a sheep barn in the village. The reasons behind his murder remain unknown. U.S. Deputy Secretary of State Antony Blinken has begun a series of security meetings with Lebanese officials. Blinken, who is in Lebanon on a two-day visit, met Foreign Minister Gibran Basil over Beirut's role in combating terrorism. Iran's nuclear deal with the West and a potential positive impact of the agreement on the region were also discussed at the meeting. Talks also tackled the issue of foreign fighters who join ISIS and efforts to counter terrorism funding. Blinken, accompanied by Ambassador David Hale, also met with Speaker Nabih Berri. Blinken had met upon his arrival in Beirut Sunday with Progressive Socialist Party leader Walid Jumblatt. MP Marwan Ahmadi, who attended the meeting at Jumblatt's residence in Beirut, said talks touch on Iran's recent nuclear deal with world powers in addition to developments in Lebanon and the region. Talks on ending the war in Syria have begun in Moscow, but the absence of a key opposition group meant there was little hope of progress in resolving the conflict. Syria's ambassador to the United Nations, Bashar al-Jafari, was heading the government delegation for the 4 days of meetings with members of the domestic tolerated opposition, the National Coordination Committee for Democratic Change, known as the NCCDC. The Western-backed exiled Syrian opposition National Coalition stayed away, and another leading domestic opposition activist remains under a travel ban from Damascus. The closed-door discussions are expected to focus on humanitarian issues and serve as a way for Russia, the main backer of the Syrian regime, in order to build a profile as a potential mediator in the conflict. Activists say the Yarmouk district in southern Damascus is experiencing continued bombardment and fighting between armed groups, a situation a UN official is describing as beyond inhumane. Chris Gunnis, a spokesman for the UNRWA, the UN agency supporting Palestinian refugees residing in the camp, said the agency has not seen or been able to send any food or any convoys into the camp since the current round of fighting. About 18,000 civilians, including 3,500 children, are trapped in Yarmouk, according to UNRWA. ISIS stormed the camp on Wednesday, launching an offensive against a Palestinian group opposed to the Syrian government. Palestinian officials and Syrian activists said ISIS was working with rivals from the Al-Qaeda affiliate in Syria, the Nusra Front. The two groups have fought each other elsewhere in Syria, but are reportedly cooperating in Yarmouk.
It has never been as grave and desperate as it is now in Yarmouk camp. It is a place that has been besieged for 2 years, where about 18,000 people have been surviving on very minimal assistance for a long time, and now, with the fighting intensifying, their lives are in immediate danger. I think here not only that there are the 18,000 civilians, but there are 3,500 children among them. And with the intensity of the confrontations, our call has been for parties to immediately suspend military operations that put civilians in danger. 3 weeks ago, I was myself in Yarmouk, and we had just negotiated with the government a new access route for distribution of much needed assistance. I talk here about food and also medical assistance for very weakened population. This is an essential element. We are ready at any time to resume these activities, but of course at this point the situation is so dangerous.
We have not been able to send any food or any convoys into the camp since the current round of fighting started. And of course that means that there is no food, there is no water, there's very little medicine. The situation in the camp is beyond inhumane. People are holed up in their houses, there's fighting going on in the streets, there are reports of aerial bombardment. This has to stop and civilians must be evacuated. I can tell you that the camp has been engulfed by intense armed conflict and the situation is very fluid and it's changing by the minute and by the hour, so it's impossible to be precise about who controls what. The fact is that 18,000 people, including 3,500 children, are at risk of death, of being maimed and of serious injury. Yarmouk camp has been under siege for nearly 2 years. It's a camp in which women have died of childbirth for lack of medicine, children have died of malnutrition. So things were bad, and things got worse when the fighting engulfed the camp. It's inhumane, and that's why we're saying there must be political action to make sure that civilians are protected and that the siege of Yarmouk can be lifted. It is very depressing that there is no political horizon right now, and as a humanitarian agency and from a humanitarian perspective, the time for humanitarian action alone has long passed. We need a political framework which will give some kind of meaning and substance to this humanitarian work, so we need political action and we need it urgently.
Coming up next, with the death toll above 147, residents are angry and are growing angrier as they say it was a government failure to prevent the bloodshed in Kenya. Stay with us. Welcome back. You're watching Future Television. U.S. President Barack Obama has said that a weakened Israel would be fundamental and a failure to his presidency, affirming solidarity with its longtime ally despite recent differences over the Iranian nuclear deal. Obama said while Israel has reason to be concerned about Iran, he defended the framework agreement on Iran's nuclear program that negotiators drew up last week. Obama made the comments to the New York Times in a 45-minute video interview on Saturday that was posted yesterday. He said he would not consider it not just a tragic failure, but he thinks it would be a moral failure, adding that no disagreements between Israel and the United States can break their bond. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has repeatedly denounced the agreement between Tehran and world powers as a bad deal, arguing it will leave Iran with a large nuclear infrastructure. The International Committee of the Red Cross says it hopes to bring vital medical supplies and aid workers into Yemen after receiving approval from the Saudi-led military coalition. The aid agency has been negotiating for nearly a week to deliver life-saving supplies and equipment to Yemen, where the coalition has conducted 11 days of airstrikes against Shia rebels known as the Houthis. The coalition now controls the country's ports and airspace. The ICRC hopes that the aircraft could land in Sana'a. However, it is still waiting approval for the IRC surgical team it plans to bring by boat into the southern city of Aden, where fighting remains intense. In Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, a spokesman for the coalition said arrangements had been made for at least one Red Cross aid delivery on Sunday morning, but the ICRC had pulled out of the arrangement. Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas is threatening to turn to the International Criminal Court over Israel's refusal to fully release hundreds of millions of dollars in tax monies owed to the Palestinian Authority. In early January, Israel froze the monthly transfer of funds it collects on behalf of the PA as a punitive measure after the Palestinians moved to join the ICC. But on Friday, Israel agreed to release the funds after deducting debts due for electricity, water and medical services. Speaking on Sunday, Abbas confirmed that two-thirds of the money had been transferred, but that the PA would send it back. A spokesman for Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu had no immediate comment. Israel started withholding about $130 million a month in tax and custom revenues in December. The move came after the Palestinians announced they were joining the ICC, a move finalized on April 1st. And with the death toll in an assault by Somali militants on a Kenyan university likely to climb above 147, anger among residents in Garissa is growing over what they say was a government failure to prevent the bloodshed. Strapped with explosives, masked as Shabab gunmen stormed the Garissa University College campus, some 200 kilometers from the Somali border, in a pre-dawn rampage last week. Tossing grenades and spraying bullets at cowering students, the attackers initially killed indiscriminately. But they later freed some Muslims and instead targeted Christian students during a siege that lasted about 15 hours. Anger over the massacre was compounded by the fact that there were warnings last week that an attack was imminent on the university. Local residents accused the authorities of doing little to boost security in this little developed region. Some also blamed locals for harboring militants. The UK's Prince Harry arrived in Australia to begin a military segment with the Australian Defence Force, ADF. After official duties at the Australian War Memorial, he met enthusiastic well-wishers outside, his only public appearance while in the country. One fellow redhead received a special high-five from the Prince. She was eager to let Harry know she was moving closer to where he lives. She said she was moving to London and trying to sneak in and let him know that. Prince Harry then reported to the Chief of Defence Force, Air Chief Marshal Mark Binskin, to begin his four-week attachment with the ADF. While on secondment with the ADF, Captain Wales, as he is known in the British Army, will live and work alongside Australian Army in regiments in Darwin, Sydney and Perth. R&B queen Beyoncé has quietly released a love song dedicated to her husband, hip-hop mogul Jay-Z, available only on his new streaming service, Tidal. Songstress Queen Bey posted a 15-second preview of the acoustic ballad Die With You on her Facebook page in celebration of the couple's 7-year wedding anniversary. She says, "I don't have a reason to be with you, but if I can't be with you," she sings, while wearing a backwards cap, blonde pigtails and appearing makeup-free. She is singing it in this video. Take a look. This marks the end of our bulletin for today. Now for a reminder of our top stories. The U.S. Deputy Secretary of State Antony Blinken holds talks with Lebanese officials during an official visit to Beirut. They touch on terrorism and the Iran nuclear deal. Activists say the Yarmouk district in southern Damascus, Syria is expecting continued bombardment and fighting between armed groups. U.S. President Barack Obama affirms solidarity with its longtime ally Israel despite recent differences over the Iranian nuclear deal. Those are your headlines live this Monday. Tune in tomorrow for what's making headlines here and around the world. Have a good one.